for tonight. I'll be reading New Testament reading this morning, which is Psalm 1-3, chapter 2, verse 8. If you have the church Bible, that would be page 1. So as you think to that, that's a bit of context. You remember from last week, we read from chapter 2, and we read that Paul was urging the prayers and speaking that it's going to be made for all people, and that this is good. Words are difficult to understand. passages like this, as Susan mentioned, with a particular lens through which we see the world. Now, these lenses are not always good or bad, but it's just the reality. But they can blur the way that we see things and give us certain biases when we read passages like this. You think that's true? For example, we may see passages like this through a particular cultural lens. I think it's fair to say that in Australia we live in a fairly egalitarian culture. We like to cut down tall poppies. We like to reciprocate when our friend buys us a beer. Unless they're my friends, then they never reciprocate. We think that men and women should work the same jobs. So it may seem a little bit strange when we come to passages like this and see that the Bible is restricting in some way women from doing certain things. Or we may see things through a particular philosophical lens. It's undeniable, isn't it, that since the 60s, feminism has shaped the way the world thinks about the roles of men and women. More recently, it's not so much feminism, but there has been a shift to thinking about the world in terms of power and oppression. And so any idea of submission and authority in the scriptures can be viewed with a level of suspicion. Or we may see things from an experiential lens. It was wonderful to hear Susan speaking about her positive experiences with men in the church. But it's also true that many women have experienced unimaginable abuse and pain and hurt at the hands of men who have had power, either in the home or, sadly, in the church context as well. Perhaps some of you have experienced these things. And so hearing about submission and authority can be deeply painful thing for you. And so before we have a look at 1 Timothy 2, I just want us all to see that when we come to passages like this, we all come with our various lenses, which can cause us to be a bit blurry in the way we see things. Again, I just want to say, that's not a good or bad thing, it's just the reality. But it is true that such lenses can blur what the text is actually saying. And so my hope and prayer this morning is that as we look at 1 Timothy 2 together, that God will, by His Spirit, remove those lenses if they need to be removed, and help us to see clearly not only what the text is saying, but that we might be convinced in our hearts that what God says to us is good and is right. As we come to this passage, it's vitally important, I think, that we understand the context of these verses. For you can see there in verse 8 that there is the little word then. You see it there? Verse 8, then or therefore, which connects our passage this morning to the verses that we saw last week. As Ray reminded us. And what did we see last week? Well, we saw the missionary heart of God, didn't we? In verse 4, God is a God who desires all people to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. Further, we saw that Jesus is the only way to be saved. For in verse 5, Paul says there is one God and there is one mediator between God and man, Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all. And further, we saw that God's mission now extends to the nations. For in verse 6, Paul says that he is an apostle now to the Gentiles. In other words, I want you to see that what Paul says here is about the roles of men and women in the church does not come in a vacuum in this book. It's not as though Paul simply wants to lay out a few arbitrary rules for men and for women. Rather, what Paul says here about the role of men and women is deeply, deeply connected to the mission of God and the salvation of the world. That is, if we want to see the instruction is given to the men. And the call here is for Christian men to be spiritual men. In verse 8, Paul says, "I desire then that in every place the men should pray, lifting holy hands without anger or wrath." The setting here is the church gathering. The phrase "in every place" is a phrase that comes from Malachi chapter 1, verse 11, which we just read before. And it's a phrase that is used in various places in the New Testament to speak of every place that the church gathers. The instruction is for Christian men to pray, lifting holy hands without anger or quarreling. I think the idea of lifting hands here is a cultural expression. In the Bible, we see various postures, physical postures for prayer. Some bow before God in prayer, and some kneel in prayer. Lots of people do face plants in front of God in prayer. And the important thing here is not the physical posture of prayer, but what the lifting of hands is opposite to. And what is the lifting of hands in opposite to here? Well, it's opposite to men lifting their hands in anger or quarreling, isn't it? There's a particular temptation for men to lift their hands in anger and in violence and animosity. I live in Strathfield South, which is a colourful part of Sydney. In the past few months, I've seen two road rage incidents where men have physically come out of their cars to engage in some fisticuffs. Last week, I spoke to a police officer who said he had been called out to a domestic abuse situation where a woman was assaulting a man. And he remarked how unusual this was because in the vast majority of cases, it's the men who are abusing the women. But here, Paul's instruction to Christian men is not to raise your hand in anger and violence and disputing, but to raise your hands in prayer and dependence on God. In other words, if the church is going to be effective in taking the gospel to a world that is lost and hell-bound, then we need our men to be taking the lead in praying for the salvation of the souls. For that is biblical manhood. You want to be a man? Learn to pray, says God. And so, biblical manhood is not about having a six-pack. It's not about the salary you earn. It's not about the number of cylinders in your car. It's not about the facial hair or any of the other ridiculous things that come up when you Google manhood. No, it's about taking spiritual leadership in the church, especially in praying for the salvation of the lost. It's about taking initiative rather than being passive and lazy and leaving, that stuff to the women. And so to the blokes, are you taking spiritual leadership in the church by praying for others and for the salvation of the world? Are you the ones who are leading and taking the lead in praying in your homes and in your growth groups and when you are at church? Are you the first to sign up when we put on prayer breakfast? During morning tea, I know we speak about a lot of things, and it's lovely to be able to share our lives together. Whenever I'm at morning tea, I usually have a conversation about the Premier League, or I hear conversations about how hard work is at the moment, or how much you're looking forward to the next holiday. These are all good things. But when And if we read on, we can see that Paul goes on to give specific instructions to the women in the church. And they are instructed about how they are to dress. I say this with a bit of tongue in cheek, but God wants well-dressed women. You see there in verse 9, can't you? Verse 9, likewise also that women should adorn themselves in respectable apparel, with modesty and self-control, not with braided hair and gold or pearls or costly attire, but with what is proper for women who profess godliness with good works. You see, this is an encouragement for Christian women to dress well, isn't it? What does it mean to dress well? What is the kind of clothing that is appropriate for godly women? Well, it is to adorn yourself with good works. Of course, Paul is not saying here that Christian women are to deliberately go out of their way to dress in a frumpy, unattractive, and outdated way. This is not a command to never go and get hair extensions, or own a Gucci handbag, or have a designer label on any of your clothing. But it is to say that in God's eyes, which are the eyes that really matter, beauty is not about these externals, but about godly character and good works, which in God's sight is very, very precious. And my dear sisters, I want you to see just how good and liberating this actually is, what God says here. For there is incredible pressure by the world for women to look and dress in a particular way in order to be beautiful, isn't it? That's why the women's global fashion industry is worth almost $1 trillion, which is more than double men's fashion. That is why there is an epidemic of eating disorders and problems among young girls. Further, women now face more and more pressure to dress in sexually provocative ways because the world largely views women as sexual objects for the gratification of men. Now, I actually have a friend who started her own clothing business for young girls because she noticed that whenever she went to the shops, she couldn't find any decent clothing for her daughters. The clothing which is not sexualized in any way, crop tops, mini shorts, sexualized slogans on the front. But how wonderfully liberating that God says that true beauty, true value, is found not in these things, but in good works. Now, without meaning to sound patronizing, I think the women in our church do quite well in this regard. I worry about a lot of things as your pastor. I must say, there has really not been many instances where I've worried about this part of our ministry, because our women do so well in this regard. But I do understand that the temptation for many women is to spend inordinate amounts of time and money and thinking on what to wear rather than on good works. And that is a particular temptation for our sisters. And so if you are a woman here, I want to ask you, do you value what God values? Do you value the imperishable beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit? verses 11 to 12, you have the instructions. In verses 13 to 14, you have the reasons. And finally, in verse 15, you have the application. And so firstly, you can see the instructions to the church about the role of women in verse 11. Let's have a look. In verse 11, Paul says, "Let a woman learn quietly with all submissiveness. I do not permit a woman to teach or to exercise authority over a man. So you can see there that in the church gathering, women are instructed to be learners. That is, Christian women are not encouraged to switch off their brains, chain themselves to the kitchen sink, and just produce babies, which the Bible is often caricatured as saying. Rather, they are to be engaged in the activity of learning in the church. And yet, they are to learn in a particular way, aren't they? The word quietly that you see there does not mean silence or not speaking a word at church, as some older translations have it. It can't mean silence because in the New Testament, women are encouraged to do all sorts of things and engage in speaking in the church, to pray, to prophesy, and to encourage one another. That Paul has already used the word in verse 2, if you remember from last week, to refer not to silence, but living with good order and without causing unnecessary disturbance. Further, the word submissiveness here doesn't mean that all women are to submit to every man. Remember, the setting that Paul has in mind here is the Christian gathering, as we've seen already. So he's talking about women submitting to those who teach and to have authority in the church. However, there is a real prohibition here, isn't there? For Paul says, he does not permit a woman to teach or to have authority over a man. I do not permit a woman to teach or to have the word teach here means to teach. I'm not particularly convinced with books and scholars that say that the word teach in this verse is used in a highly technical sense to refer to a particular kind of teaching that we no longer have in the modern church anymore. Rather, I'm convinced that to teach has its usual meaning of giving instruction through words and through the life of the teacher, which is opposite to learning. Further, notice that the teaching which is not permitted for women is authoritative teaching. That is, I don't think the idea of teaching and authority, as you see there in verse 12, I don't think those two ideas are speaking about two distinct unrelated things. Rather, what Paul is not permitting women to do in a church gathering is the authoritative teaching of God's word to the congregation. Now, I don't know the exact form of teaching that was kind of done in the early church, the exact form of the authoritative teaching that Paul would have witnessed in the early church. But I think the closest parallel we would have in our modern day is the sermon that is given in the context of our regular church gatherings. And so one implication is that women are not to be involved in that activity or in the role of eldership in the church, which is the particular teaching responsibility of men. And that's why in our church we don't invite women to preach to this mixed congregation on a Sunday, nor do we have women elders in our church. But why does Paul say this? Why are women not permitted to teach or to have authority over a man? Is this just Paul, the misogynist, trying to put women said there in verses 13 to 14, what is Paul saying there? Well, he says, for Adam was formed first, and Eve, and Adam was not deceived, but the woman was deceived and became a transgressor. Now, if you know your Bible, you will know that the sin that Paul describes in verse 13 comes from Genesis chapter 2, and the sin that Paul describes in verse 14 comes from Genesis 3. But I want you to see that in both verses, Paul is making a very similar point, and that is that right from the creation of the world, God made man and woman differently with different roles. That's what he's saying. And so in Genesis chapter 2, we do see that Adam was formed first and then Eve. It's not that Eve was in any way inferior to the man. No, both Adam and Eve were created equally in the image of God and were precious to God, we're told. But they were also given different roles. Adam was given the lead role in working both the garden, and Eve was given the role of being a helper to Adam, if you remember. You see, this is something that our world finds very hard to understand. Our world does not understand how you can be equal and yet different in your roles that require submission and authority. For the way our world thinks about equality is to be the same in everything. And so when the world hears about women submitting to the authority of men in the Bible, what many hear is inequality and injustice and misogyny, rather than immediately thinking that there is a goodness to what God says. And yet the Bible continues to teach that you can be equal and yet have different roles to play that require submission and authority. And you see it in the very Godhead, don't you? The Father and the Son are equal. And yet the Son willingly and joyfully submits to the authority of the Father. You see it in everyday life. When a policeman pulls me over on the side of the road to give me a breath test, I immediately submit to his authority without ever raising questions about equality. In fact, last week, we had a police officer in our new colour gallery where the roles were then reversed, and he submitted to my authority. But what does it mean in verse 14 that the woman was deceived? Well, again, I don't think Paul's point here is that the woman is inferior to the man in any way. It's not like Paul is, excusing the man for not being deceived and then blaming the woman for being deceived and throwing the world into the chaos of sin. Nor is Paul implying that the woman is somehow morally or intellectually or emotionally inferior to the man. What Paul is saying is that in Genesis chapter 3, the whole created order was turned upside down in the fall. For the woman was deceived by the serpent, who tempted her to eat of the fruit of the tree. And yet, what was the man doing? Well, he was just standing passively, not doing anything. Was he? That is, he was not deceived, but arguably he committed the greater sin because he knew what God had said about the fruit, and yet rather than leading his wife, he listened to his wife and plunged the world into a chaos of sin. That's why in the New Testament, sin comes not from Eve, but from Adam. So, friends, now the reason why Paul does not permit a woman to teach or to have authority over a man in the church gathering is fundamentally because church is to reflect the roles that God has given to men and women in the created order. And that's why I'm not particularly convinced by people who argue that what Paul writes in 1 Timothy be saved through childbearing if they continue in faith and love and holiness with filth and clean. But what on earth is he talking about here? And it's funny that during this week, as I spoke to some of you about this, almost every single one of you said to me the words, good luck. Can I ask you to turn to the person sitting next to you and ask one of them, like, what do you think this verse means? Verse 16. Yet she will be saved through childbearing if they continue in faith and love and holiness with self-control. What do you think that means? What's Paul getting at there? Turn to the person sitting next to you and have a breath conversation about that. All right, friends, we don't have a lot of time, so let me get you to get us together. Does anyone want to bravely offer a suggestion about what this verse might be talking about? Yeah. So did everyone hear that? I'm talking about godliness. And perhaps if I could just extend that a bit further, the godliness of women in embracing things like childbearing, which is a particularly female. There's no way that I'll ever be able to bear a child in the way that our sisters can. Now, of course, that's not to say that this is talking about every woman having to have children, but it is. But that view says that women will be saved as they embrace their God-given roles as women, childbearing being one of those roles, one of those representative roles. And I think Paul here is espousing a salvation by works. You have children and you'll be saved. But it's talking about women of faith who trust God and who gladly embrace the role that God has given to them. I think that makes more sense of our passage. And so, that's the one I'm going to go with today. That's the one I'm going to go with today. I think it makes the most sense across the passage. Now, friends, time is running out, so I'm going to wrap things up. But what does all this mean for us? We've learned a lot of things today. What does this all mean? What does all this mean for us? And especially for our women? Well, I think when we come to passages like this, it's easy to think that God is trying to restrict women in some way. I mean, women are just as intelligent as men, just as capable as men in many areas, and just as gifted as men, especially when it comes to teaching. And so why is God restricting women from doing the teaching at church? Now, it is true that God does draw some clear boundaries here, doesn't he, for women in the church. So on the one hand, I think it's clear that women are not to give them a sermon in the context of a Sunday gathering or a church gathering. On the other hand, I think it's clear that women should not be the elders of a church whose job it is to teach and to exercise authority in the church. But within those boundaries that God has given to 75% of those people are either women or children under the age of 15. That's 6 billion people. So the point is that there is no shortage of people whom women are to teach and to have an impact on them in ways that men simply can. But what God does say in passages like 1 Timothy 2 is that in the church there are roles that men are to play, and there are roles that women are to play. And this is good, not only for the health of the church, but ultimately for the mission of the church, which is to reach the lost. But you know, friends, the world is a place where men and women are constantly battling one another. We live in a world where some women accuse all men of toxicity. In a world where, with the rise of pornography, many men simply view women as sexual objects for their gratification. We live in a world that is now in confusion more than ever about what it is to be a man and what it is to be a woman. But in stark contrast, God says that in the church, men are to fulfill their God-given roles by leading, praying and teaching in love for the good and health of others. And that women are to play their roles in doing good works and submitting to the God-given authorities in their lives. And I want to suggest that when this is done right, and I think we have a lot of work to do in figuring out how to do this well, but I want to suggest that when this is done right, good for us. It is good for the mission of the church, for it comes from a God who himself is good and wants good for us. We pray with you. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are our Creator and that you have made us male and female, equal